flaming out.
Hey, welcome to the Presbyterian Church of Lawrenceville Online. My name is Kyle, and I'm one of the pastors here at the church. Whether you're a longtime member or friend of our congregation or a first-time guest with us, we are so glad that you have joined us for worship this morning. We're online, and so I encourage you to take advantage of that chat feature there to the right of your screen. If you're viewing this service on a mobile device, that chat feature will be down below. Someone from our church will be online during our live stream looking to engage with you. If you have any comments or concerns, prayer requests or needs, we do encourage you to share those with us. We'll try to respond to all of those as they come in. You can use that chat feature for just such a thing. If you'd like, you can also email any requests to our Associate for Pastoral Care Ministries, Jill Cifelli. Know that we continue to pray with and for one another. If you're sharing requests in the comments publicly, just a reminder, please don't include last names so that we can maintain one another's privacy. Engage with this service. Use the Facebook reactions as the service goes. Consider sharing your comments throughout the service. Like this post or share our video on Facebook. Even you might consider starting a watch party. It's never been easier to invite your friends and your family members to church. And so we encourage you to do that. Also, sing loudly. All of the words to the songs that we'll include in our worship service will be there on the screen for you. So sing like nobody's watching. All right. And finally, several of you have asked about how you might support PCOL during these times. And it's never been easier to do that. We encourage you to visit our website, pclawrenceville.org. And there at the top right-hand corner of the webpage, you'll see a blue button labeled Donate. Go ahead and click there and you can give a contribution to our church. Whether you're watching us live or you're catching up with us later in the week on Facebook or YouTube, we are so glad that you've decided to join us. And we look forward to worshiping God together. Good morning and welcome to the Presbyterian Church of Lawrenceville Online. Like I just said in that video, we're so excited that you are here with us for worship. So welcome. We have a few announcements to share with you this morning as we prepare for worship. First among them is to make sure that you've found that link there in the chat that has been pinned. You can find our order of worship and download it by clicking that link. In addition to using that to guide you in your worship this morning, there are also a number of announcements and things that are happening here at the church that are included in that document. So we encourage you and commend that document to you. Please do download it and read up on what's going on. If you didn't know or you missed it, this morning is a communion Sunday. And so hopefully you have already prepared your elements for communion later in the worship service. If you've not done so, we invite you to make sure that you do that prior to the time when we celebrate that sacrament together. Again, you just need some kind of liquid, coffee, juice, water, whatever you have on hand, and some kind of bread or a cracker or a cookie. Gosh, it doesn't matter what you have on hand. Know that we will celebrate together and God will be present in our celebration. Excuse me, I don't even know what I was going to say there. But in the fall is coming around, and that means that we're going to be starting a new confirmation class in September. We're looking at what that might look like for us. And so normally we invite students who are entering high school, ninth grade students, rising ninth grade students, to participate in confirmation. But really, confirmation is for any high school student who's not gone through it. And so if you are in that category and you're interested in more information about confirmation, I'd like to invite you and your parents to join me for an information meeting next Sunday after worship at 11:30 on Zoom. That information can be found on our website, and we'll share that in the link, certainly, or in the chat. We'll share that link with you in the chat, certainly next week, so that you have it. It's just an information meeting. It is not by any means a commitment to participate in confirmation, but come, ask questions, learn about the program, get some more information. We hope to see you there. Also know that throughout the summer, on a sort of bi-weekly rotation, Wink has continued. Normally we take the summer off, but given the circumstances we find ourselves in, we thought it was important to continue to stay connected, to check in with one another, to pray together. So Wink is happening tonight at 5 o'clock on Zoom. You can find the link for that on our Facebook page, both our Presbyterian Church of Lawrenceville Facebook page and the Worship in a New Key Facebook page. Later this afternoon, that link will be shared. So please do join us for that. We mentioned last week, there's a letter from Jeff Vamos, our pastor, and from David Sung, our clerk of session. In the order of worship, you'll find that, about per capita. And so it's that time of year where we start to think about our per capita apportionment. And it's a reminder that we are part of a connectional church, part of a larger church. And one way that we participate in the mission and ministry of the larger church together here in Lawrenceville and throughout our country is by paying our per capita. And so I invite you to read that letter and to consider giving to that ministry. You can do that by visiting our website, again, and clicking that donate link. And you'll find an option for per capita in the drop-down. You might remember we've mentioned that we're looking at planning a virtual bingo night for the community as a way to bring the community together, to have some fun together, but also to raise awareness for local nonprofits within Lawrence Township and hopefully raise some money to fight hunger and to provide means for those in our community who are less fortunate. That event is happening Friday. I believe it's August 25th is the date, but we're still looking for some help with that. So there's a link, there will be a link in the chat there on Facebook for you to sign up to help out with that event. If for some reason the link isn't working or you're looking to connect with somebody, you can reach out to Jeff or to Doug Lewandowski, who is sort of running the show with that game night. And just a reminder, hopefully in your email you noticed that we sent out a survey on behalf of our Returning to In-Person Activities Task Force here at the church. You might remember last week, Chris Denny made an announcement about that survey. It has gone out. We're asking for your feedback, for your ideas, and for information from you as we think about what transitioning to in-person activities here at PCOL will look like. And so your feedback will help us determine what we do next and how we implement those kinds of policies. So please do fill those out. We're hoping to be able to analyze and evaluate those responses by July 24. So please do get that survey filled out. That concludes our announcements this morning. And so I invite you now to quiet your hearts and your minds as we prepare for worship together. You are here.
itself apart.
Friends, God has abundantly cast God's seed of love and grace upon all of us. May we be fruitful soil for the planting and growing of hope and peace in our own lives and in the world around us. And so with joy and thanksgiving, let us praise God who is so generous with us. Let us worship God together.
Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Feed me till I want no more. Open now the crystal fountain, whence the healing stream doth flow. Let the fire and cloudy pillar lead me on my journey through. Strong deliverer, be thou still my strength and shield. Be thou still my strength and shield.
One of the essential aspects of our Reformed way of worshiping is to prepare our hearts by confessing how we fall short of God's grace and God's glory. And so let us take a moment as we worship in our homes or wherever we are to turn our hearts toward God as we confess our sins. Let us pray. Holy God, as nature sings, as creation unfolds according to the pattern of your will, help us to wonder, to marvel, to see the true beauty you have placed in all things and in us the ability to see it. Awesome God, help us to bear the awe we ought to feel in the presence of your creation. And God, it's clear that in feeling such awe, we are forced to our knees. The beauty around us is a background against which to see that which is lacking in ourselves. Holy One, save us from the temptation to believe that through our own efforts alone, we can fix ourselves and the problems we see within us and around us. We especially lift up the biases and attitudes that may even be unconscious, which do not fit the pattern of your love and justice. God, help us to see that and help us to find healing. And in confessing our need for you and our own brokenness, We know that we receive your healing grace, your redeeming justice. God, we offer this as we also lift up our own personal prayers of confession in the silence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen. I would invite you to stand in body or in spirit, wherever you are, whatever you might do, truly to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And all of us with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel, that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven, healed, redeemed, and set free. Alleluia. Amen.
That's right, I need a microphone, don't I? Maybe it's easier for you to hear. Sorry about that. Yeah, so it wasn't easy if you were a student. It certainly wasn't easy if you were a teacher toward the end of the year. So it's important for us to think about our teachers and think about how important they are. Because today, Jesus was teaching a lesson, and the way he taught was by telling stories called parables. And in this story that we're about to hear in just a minute, Jesus sat in a boat because there were so many people. They were there at the beach. There was such a crowd, he went out into a boat to teach them. And he told them a story about a person, could have been a guy or a gal, who had a huge bag of seed. Imagine this huge bag of seed. And this person scattered the seed everywhere, you know, all over the place. Didn't matter where. It might have been rocky soil, weedy soil, good soil. And especially the seed that went into the good soil grew up into really wonderful plants that gave lots of nice fruits and vegetables, and they became really wonderful, and everybody loved them. And you know what? Teachers are kind of like that person who put the seeds on the ground. But instead of putting seeds in the ground, sometimes we might think of teachers as putting ideas in our head. So just like a person puts a seed in the ground, a teacher puts an idea in your head, in your brain, and that idea might become important. And those ideas might grow in you. And you know what else teachers do is they might help you understand who you are. Because for me, teachers were really important because they saw a seed growing in me that was important. So I'll give you an example of that. There was one teacher who said to me, you know, you're good at speaking. And that really made a difference for me because I started thinking about maybe that's a gift that I have that I should pay attention to. And actually, that's become a big part of my life and what I do because I speak to people. And you know what? That might not have happened if a teacher hadn't put that idea, just like a seed in the ground, an idea in my head, that maybe that's a gift that I have. So a couple of things I want to suggest to you. One is that Jesus, you know, spread seeds all over the place that were really ideas from the Bible. The ideas from the Bible kind of went into people's heads and for some people made such a huge difference in their life. Just like that sower who threw the seeds all over the place and those seeds became beautiful plants, these ideas become beautiful things inside of us. That's what Jesus does. But you know, something you might want to talk about with your parents or the people taking care of you at your lunch table or your dinner table is, what are the things growing inside you, maybe things that God's given you, that you need to tend like a gardener, water and weed, so that they might become beautiful things. And the other thing I want you to think about is, maybe you should thank those teachers that have been really good to you. I think they might really appreciate that. Well, boys and girls, thanks so much for taking some time with me this morning. I hope you could hear me at the beginning. I'm sorry, I forgot my microphone today. But blessings to you all. And right now, we're going to hear that story that I just talked about, the parable of the sower from Matthew's gospel. So our scripture reading, as I mentioned a moment ago, is from the Gospel according to Matthew, and this is from the 13th chapter of Matthew's Gospel. Hear the word of the Lord. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower, a person with seeds, went out to sow, to plant seeds. And as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen." He put before the... Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me? Generous God, we've gathered this morning to offer our praise and our worship to you. We've gathered this morning to hear a word from you. For we know that we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. And the proclamation of your word, speak to us anew, that we might be changed by your Holy Spirit, and by the good news of your gospel. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. So I have to confess, and you might have guessed this, but I'm no farmer. I don't know much about sowing seed at all, but I do have just a little bit of experience with grass seed. Maybe some of you do as well. And I'm certainly no expert at growing grass either, but I think I've done enough YouTube research to know that you have to prepare the ground before you put the grass seed down. About 8 years ago or so, I had done a ton of landscaping work in our backyard, sort of overhauling the whole yard, and there were a couple of patches of bare ground there that needed some grass. And so I dug up those bare patches of ground with a shovel so that the soil there was nice and loose. And then I raked that loose soil to create little furrows in the ground where the grass seed could catch and hold. Then I scattered the grass seed evenly over those patches, being careful not to waste any of it because grass seed is actually surprisingly expensive, isn't it? Then I put down some straw to hold in the moisture and to deter the birds from coming and eating that grass seed. And then twice a day, sometimes even more if I was really motivated, I'd water that grass gently, hopefully to encourage it to grow and to give it enough moisture so that it can germinate without washing away the seed. After about a week or so, a little bit of green fringe, a little bit of grass started to grow up in that place where I had planted that grass seed. According to my probably less than extensive YouTube research, this is kind of the textbook way to sow seed, or at least grass seed. As Presbyterians, we might say that the best way to grow seed is to do it decently in an order. There's a process here. And the good results that I had with the grass would seem proof enough of that conclusion, right? Which makes this parable of the sower all the more baffling to me. And maybe you caught it in Jeff's children's message when he talked about the sower going out and just sowing seed everywhere. This sower, if we can even call him that, has clearly never seen a single YouTube video about sowing seed. And he's certainly not a Presbyterian. There's nothing decent in order about his methods. Instead of carefully preparing his plot of ground, and instead of carefully scattering the seed, he seems to be walking all over the place, right? Throwing big, wasteful handfuls of seed just up in the air, wherever it may be. Some of it falls there on the road where the birds come along and eat it up. But really, what would we expect if we sow seed on the road? Some of it falls into the gravel where it sprouts after the first good rain, but it withers away because there's no dirt there for the roots to really go down into. But again, what would we expect if we sow seed on gravel? Still, some of the seed falls among the weeds and the thorns, and ultimately it gets choked out by the competition. But again, right, what would we expect if we start sowing seed this way? The only surprise in this story, it seems to me, again, no farming experience, struggle to keep anything alive that's green. The only thing that's surprising to me is that this seemingly reckless and wasteful, sad excuse for a seed sower manages to get any of the seed at all on good soil, and that it produces not just a yield, but a miraculous yield of 30 or even 60 or even 100 times as much grain. We have to keep in mind that the author of Matthew's gospel is writing to a Jewish audience living in a province of the Roman Empire, which was an agrarian society with no middle class. And so Matthew's readers were local business persons, artisans, and probably the vast majority of them were peasant farmers and fishermen. When we hear the parable today, it's easy for us to overlook the sowing strategy, or the lack thereof, I guess, and to focus on the soil. We tend to wonder if we're the good soil or not. We hope that we're the good soil, but in the back of our heads, we're thinking maybe we're the rocky soil or the thorny soil. This is the parable of the sower, isn't it? It's not the parable of the soil. It's about the sower. And it's that part of the parable, the actions of the sower, that I think would have caught the attention of those listening to Jesus' teaching. The fact that a farmer would be so reckless and wasteful, yet still managed to produce an abundance of crops, again, is perhaps the only part of that parable that might have upset the expectations of Jesus' original hearers. And I think we need to pay attention to that, right? Because the goal of a parable, the purpose of a parable, was about upsetting expectations. As Jesus told them, parables weren't meant to be charming little stories to illustrate a point. They were rhetorical tools. Tools that he used in the way that a builder might use a bulldozer or a wrecking ball to kind of level the hearer's expectations, to clear the ground for a new understanding. At this point in Matthew's gospel, there was a kind of division that was beginning to emerge between those who were responding favorably to Jesus' teaching and those who were rejecting Jesus and his teaching. And so Matthew 13, this whole chapter, kind of interrupts the larger narrative of Matthew's gospel to present us with not only this parable, but several parables, seven, to reflect on the emerging division that's happening. The word parable itself is derived from a Greek word meaning to throw alongside. Basic to the parable genre is the notion of comparison. One entity is set alongside of or thrown alongside of something else in order to be illuminated by comparison. Thus, in this context, the kingdom of heaven is thrown alongside of or compared to and illuminated by the situations that each one of these parables depicts. And at the risk of oversimplifying a bit, the point of the parables here in Matthew 13 is to illustrate how God is at work in our world. How God is at work in our world and to challenge their hearers both then and today to reflect on the kingdom of God and what it means for us to be called the people of God. I can't help but wonder if that sower ever wised up about the good soil and the rocky soil or the thorny soil. I wonder if he ever evaluated the results of his sowing strategy in order to plant smarter the next time, right? Isn't that what we're concerned about? What's the sort of cost analysis? What's the return on investment here? But the parable doesn't talk about it next time. According to Jesus, this is how the sower operates. This is how the sower chooses to operate. The parable of the sower reminds us that God is reckless with grace, that God is extravagant, even wasteful with love. We're reminded that the grace and love of God is for the whole world, not just for those who are likely to respond to it. And I think that says something about the way that we ought to approach our own ministries, both as a church and as Christian people in general. I wonder, will we take part in the growth of God's kingdom here in Lawrenceville, in New Jersey, in the world? Will we further it? Will we enjoy its fruits? Are we living in ways that cause us to choke and lose confidence in God's word, which is sown among us? It isn't always clear how we're doing with this. Truth be told, we do the best that we can, but it's not always clear how we're doing with this. And in order to understand, we have to listen to our own lives. We have to listen to the words of those around us. And we have to listen and look for God's movement in and around us as well by the Holy Spirit. I think this parable challenges us to look for God here and now, to live into our ministries and to move into the future with trust in God. I think this invitation to do that involves understanding that God has made all ground holy by scattering God's word upon the ground, whatever ground that we might find ourselves on. rocky or thorny or obviously good. All ground has been made holy. I think it's about walking our paths with confidence, knowing and trusting that God's got this, that God knows what God is doing, that God's word is powerful, that God's grace is enough, and that wherever we are, we're invited to see and to share in God's harvest together. If Jesus had been sowing grass seed in my backyard, I might have found him tossing huge handfuls of seed up onto the roof of the garage, or maybe onto the concrete patio or over the neighbor's fence. I could sort of only imagine that conversation, right? Jesus? Yes? What are you doing, Jesus? I'm sowing grass seed, he might say. Yeah, but you're not getting it anywhere close to that little patch of bare ground over there where I'm trying to grow grass. Oh, is that what you're trying to do? Yeah, Jesus, what are you trying to do? I'm trying to get some grass to grow, and it doesn't seem to be growing there. I mean, look at it. You've got a yard full of grass, and the one place that it doesn't want to grow is that little piece of dirt over there. So I'm trying some other places. The roof of the garage, Jesus? The patio over the fence? Well, you never know, right? And I think that's true, isn't it? We never really do know, because Jesus wasn't doing something as predictable as sowing grass seed. He was trying to sow the word of God on the unpredictable soil of the human heart. And not only is the human heart unpredictable, it's invisible, which means that we can't tell just by looking at somebody what kind of heart they have, or what it is that they're wrestling with or experiencing. Again, I can't help but wonder where kingdom growth may be happening around us today, right now, even though we can't see it yet. These days, I think it can be really hard to see or even to trust that God is at work in the world. When we turn on the TV or get online, it seems everything around us just looks so thorny or rocky. We see racism in our society and even in the church. And most days we feel unsure about how to continue to be the church in the midst of this ever-changing landscape of the pandemic. Everyone, it seems, has already made up their minds about the pandemic, about the economy, about any issue pertaining to racism, that we wonder if there really is actually any good soil out there. We wonder if growth is even possible. What is God up to? But I think Jesus reminds us here that stones and thorns and death are all a part of life. Through this parable, we're invited on a journey of transformation, whereby we look for God here and now, listening for the forgiveness, comfort, and joy that God offers, not just despite the thorny or the rocky ground, but maybe even through it and in it. I wonder what our racism can teach us about the ways that we deny God's goodness in each other and in ourselves. I wonder what we can learn from our increasing diversity about the richness of God's creation and God's determination to bless all people everywhere. I wonder what this pandemic will continue to teach us about what it means to be the church. I wonder how, even without being together in person, we might continue to find ways to stand together, looking for God's goodness in one another's lives and listening for God wherever we might find ourselves. For God has made all ground holy, maybe even especially the difficult ground where we seem to be finding ourselves a lot these days. Let anyone with ears listen, Jesus said after telling this parable. Listen, he urged his friends, for the word was being sown, a powerful word, a transformative word, but maybe not an obvious word. That word is also sown for us to hear, for us to nurture, and for us to enjoy. Let anyone with ears listen. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Friends, let us pray. Loving God, on this day, we stand in the need of prayer. At a time when global and national chaos has created personal and family chaos and sorrow, challenges for our families, sickness for acquaintances and loved ones, economic hardship for many, Lord, enable us to use this as a time to turn our hearts toward what is most important, to seek you, to seek your grace, to allow the gospel to grow in us. It is ironic that those seeds of the gospel planted in us through many a sermon, many a service, might take root in us precisely because of this difficulty we are all experiencing. God, make us good soil in bad times, in which the fruit of your word and your spirit might take even deeper root. God, help us to do that through concrete acts of love for our neighbor, those affected by COVID, those affected by racism, those touched by mental illness, to list just a few examples. Make us instruments of your peace, gentle gardeners inspired by your own love and care. And so we pray for our broken and ragged world, our leaders who so desperately need your wisdom, for our neighbors and for ourselves. And we lift up these personal prayers in the silence. And Holy God, as we approach this table as we partake of this feast, we ask that you would enable us to pray, and not just with our words, but with our lives. We pray this as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You know, one of the joyful burdens, as Kyle spoke of last week, that comes with being a Christian, that comes with being good soil, is the responsibility to respond to grace with grace, to respond to the profound gift of God's love by giving of our own treasure and of our own time and of our own giftedness. And so as a ritual we perform every week on Sunday, we give and we make that an act of worship. You can do that online. Usually we do it by putting something in the plate here, but of course you can do that virtually. Simply go to our website. You see that button, whether it's red or blue, I'm not sure, on the upper right hand. If you click it, you can give to any of the funds and needs that are part of our ministry here at the Presbyterian Church of Lawrenceville. So do that. Please give out of gratitude, not out of guilt, but out of response to the amazing grace that you have understood from our Lord and Savior Jesus. Let us now give of our gifts and our offerings.
Two, three, four.
Down in the valley of shadows of death.
Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. People will come from north and south and east and west to sit at table in the kingdom of God. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at table with his disciples, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. Their eyes were opened and they recognized him. All of us by the Holy Spirit are gathered together at the Lord's table. Our Savior invited those who trust him to share the feast which he has prepared.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Let us pray. Praise to you, O God, for all of your works. You created the world and called it good. And you made us in your image to live together in love. You made a covenant with us. And even when we turned from you, you remained ever faithful. Thank you, O God, for sending us your Son, Jesus Christ. He lived among us and told us your story. He healed the sick and he welcomed the sinners. He shared our pain and died our death, then rose to new life that we might live. And that all of creation might be restored. Amen.
We give thanks to God that on the night of his arrest and betrayal, Jesus sat at table with his disciples, and taking bread, after he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after the supper, Jesus took the cup, and pouring it out, he said, "This cup is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me." Remembering God's boundless love revealed to us in Jesus Christ, we break bread and share this cup, giving of ourselves to one another and to God in joy and praise.
Let us pray. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these, your gift of the bread and cup. May they be for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ, and may we be his body for the world. By your Spirit, unite us with Christ and with one another until we feast with him and with all of your saints in your eternal realm of justice and peace. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen.
Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Come to me and you will never hunger." Jesus said, "I am the vine and you are the branches. Believe in me and you will never thirst." The bread of life and the cup of salvation, the gifts of God for the people of God. One of the miraculous aspects of our God is the notion that God can be present in the ordinary gifts of bread and cup. And that grace is also effective across distance. And so wherever you are, partake of the gifts that you have prepared in the faith and belief that Christ is present spiritually in them. And now let us partake of our communion together. body of Christ broken for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ. Amen.
Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and the cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ. Make us one with all of your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Holy Spirit that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
We invite you to take a moment to share a sign of Christ's peace with those with whom you're gathered, and certainly with those who are gathered online virtually. And as you do so, I invite you to join us in our closing hymn. The words will be there on your screen. Friends, this service of worship has come to an end. Go forth from this place or from your place, wherever you may be, to sow the seed of God's grace and love wherever you go, on whatever soil you may find yourselves on. For God brings forth fruit from unexpected places. And may the God whose forgiveness is boundless, Jesus Christ, whose charge is freedom, and the Holy Spirit, who grants us life and peace, keep our minds and our hearts in grateful communion as we from this place go to love and serve God and one another. Amen. Just go to the postlude then.
And I presume that the... Sorry, folks. Hope that you can join us for our Zoom coffee hour. I presume the link is there. Hope to see you in a moment, live and on Zoom.